Praise the Lord. Shall we bow our heads to pray? Our Father, we appreciate the grace you've given us to be at your feet this morning. We humbly vow that you may open the eyes of our understanding and make our path grow from glory to glory by the power that is in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. So quickly, we want to run through the power of love, part two. It's captioned standard setting. Standard setting. The secret of change is to focus all your energy not on fighting the old, but on building the new. Unquote by Ella Randall. The way that you can bring change to focus is not to dwell in the past, but to be focused on the future. Most Christians don't achieve much in certain areas of their lives because they fail to set high standards for themselves. Jesus set some very high ones for us that border on the absolute. Without these absolutes, we will have very little or no achievements at all. Barely living from day to day how we've always done while expecting change is foolishness. The easiest way to live life, everyone knows this, is to continue living it how you know it. But that is not the life of successful people. And that is why God allows challenges to meet with us so that we are compelled to think and rethink. Because successful people look at where they are coming from, find the challenges they are facing, and devise new solutions. Because they have changed from the previous routine, they can have a different result. So we can say that change comes from a mental budget of change. A mental budget of change. People have plans. Everyone has aspirations. But not everyone gets there at the same time. Many people think that challenges are peculiar to them. Ask anyone who ever made success out of life. They will tell you how many times they fell. They will tell you how many difficulties they went through. So because you see them up there, you think God has forgotten you. The road you are traveling on, they traveled it too. So we have to have that mental change so that we can think like those who have gone before and get to where they have gotten to. Because there is another class of people who didn't continue at all. They gave up. That is the class of failures. This thing has always been there. I don't want to do this again. So Haggai chapter 1 verse 5 gives us a little window. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Consider your ways. Why? Because there could be something wrong. And unless you deal with it, then it becomes a problem. Well, this sermon is not to proclaim how perfect we are. It is just a roadmap that we can follow individually or collectively to get out of our quagmire. We must, like St. Paul said, forget those things that are behind and press towards the mark. It's simple mathematics then to conclude that if we can change our thinking, we can change our ways. Until God said, start in Nigeria, I had no desire to remain here. But you are not God. There are many plans that you have. But if that is not God's plan, you will be foolish to quarrel with God. Because before you were born, He knew the reason why. He knew where you ought to be. And if we continue without understanding, because you cannot have love without understanding, then we will fail. God forbid. It will not be our portion in the name of Jesus. And because human beings are creatures of habit, one of the most difficult things to do is change. Even to change from 1 hour earlier to waking up 1 hour before is a struggle. But to say, let me wake up 1 hour earlier, even something so small as that, can be very difficult. Why? Because our reasoning is faulty. If people get punished for coming late, then you will want to come early. But that is because you don't have love for God. You don't have understanding of what you're doing. If you're going to work, you get late, you are scolded, your salary is withdrawn, you rush for that purpose, you don't understand what it is that we are doing here. So you have to desire it, you have to understand it, because there is no love without understanding. So unless you are not stubborn, you are not lazy, and you are not arrogant, if you are not any of these, it is easy to say, yes, I failed here, and I want to make this sacrifice here. The greatest sacrifice that you can make is the one that you make for God. Because He is the one who will judge you. And you don't know what you would do that will make Him overlook your mistakes. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. Matthew 5, 43. Ye have heard that it had been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. Well, this is an acceptable doctrine in Judaism, from which we all know Christianity evolved. Verse 44, but I say unto you, meaning that, nevertheless, I hereby introduce a new, a strong, but opposite way of living. I introduce this to you right now. It has been established. We all know that that is how it used to be. But I'm telling you now, this is how it ought to be from now on. Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. And this is one of the most difficult things to do. At this point, many of us will falter justifying the claim that this is impossible. But is it really? Jesus did it as an example for us to follow at the most difficult time of his life after his crucifixion. In life, in our most difficult times, situations such as this would arise to evaluate our worthiness to move on. How we forgive those who rejoice over our calamity will determine how far we will go with God. How you can ignore the things that people say about you and still focus. Because what the devil will want at this point is give up and forget. But if you can pick yourself up and still fight, but without bitterness, then you know that you are on course. Luke 23 verse 33. Luke chapter 23 verse 33. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. 34. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Notice that he had just finished praying for them. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Yet he watched as they parted his raiment, and they were gambling for who will win what part. He was on the cross, and he was seen. They continued with their disdain, with their mockery, and their nonchalance. How painful do you think that would have been for the master? How painful would it have been for you if you were there on the cross? If you were in his shoes, how would you have responded to their disrespect and lack of love? I can assure you that prayers will have changed immediately. Your thinking will change. So I'm praying for you and you are still doing your wickedness. Okay, Father, don't forgive them at all. Father, you are seeing them now. See how wicked they are. I'm praying for them. Fall down, die, die, die. I'm sure that would be the prayer. And you'll be praying, die, until you see the last man fall and die. It is a natural reaction. But we need to be able to desire to progress and to forgive. Because we see Jesus resolutely focused on the journey of love and forgiveness. In spite of everything that was done to him, he was focused. They insulted him, he was focused. He remained calm. He did this because he had a clear understanding of where he was headed. The glory that was waiting for him was bigger by far than the trivialities of bitterness and unforgiveness. So unless you regard where you are going as superior to what people say about you, you will miss it. Remember, do not ever let the opinion of other people become your reality. So Jesus had his own reality. He had his focus, detached from what everyone else thought about him. So this is the example that we must copy, one that we must desire, and one that we must run with. We must ignore insults, backbiting, ignore failure, and reposition ourselves for the greater task ahead. It is that brings us to the attainment of true Christian maturity. But if we practice it, only if we practice it, shall we get there. Don't think because I have decided to do this, therefore I'll just get over it once and for all. No. It is my prayer that God will give us grace to practice it until we become perfect in it, in the name of Jesus. So Jesus showed us the extreme limit of the chance to forgive. And he set the standard so that we would follow. If, and I know many people will insist that only Jesus being divine could have done this, it is good for us to examine another person who did it, Stephen. Acts chapter 7, verse 59. Acts chapter 7, verse 59. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. 60. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. If Jesus was said to be the apostle of love, love then in a Christian's life should be so all-consuming that nothing ought to be impossible before it. Because it is that which considers others immensely, so that you wish nobody no ill. You spend all your energy on yourself moving forward, instead of dissipating it on hatred and bitterness and what someone didn't say, what somebody didn't do. They are running their race, and you are running yours. They have their dreams, and you have yours. They have their homes, and you have yours. Nobody is worthy enough to derail you from your destiny. However hostile they may be, however ignorant or careless they may be, nobody is worthy enough to derail you from your destiny, because it shall be fulfilled if we persist. You have the right to choose to either ignore them or to focus on what they are saying. You have to pick yourself up and go, or you stop by and quarrel with everyone who says you're an idiot, you're a madman, you don't know what you're doing, and you're me and quarrel, you lose energy, you lose focus. It's exactly where the devil wants you to be. Through this type is achievable only through the Holy Spirit. By our flesh, nobody can. Somebody is killing you, stoning you, and you are saying, Father, forgive them. It is not a likely prayer that people would make. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. It is the Holy Spirit that makes people to love those who destroy them, who fight them, who hate them, unfriendly friends, pretending to be friends and destroying you. Only God can make you love them. So we see that we are not commanded to retaliate. We are not commanded to be bitter. We are not commanded to despise anyone. Reason being, as is recorded in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 19. Romans 12, 19. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. It wasn't Moses who fought for himself when his brothers and everyone rose up against him. I will avenge. It is best and easiest to manage when a Christian puts his trust entirely on the Lord. It is when we want to prove a point to the other person that we run into the difficult place of wanting to take the laws into our hands. I will show you who I am. Do you know what I am? Do you know because of Christ? That is why you can. That is pride. If we can die to that part of ourselves and be humble, we will get far. May that grace be given unto us in the name of Jesus. It is a function of pride to want to prove anything. But the moment you rise above that level, you will experience the kind of peace that Jesus talked about. John chapter 14, verse 27. That kind of peace that rises above all else, troubles inclusive. John 14, 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Do not worry, because everything will be all right, as long as you develop the right attitude. The peace that Jesus brings to us is not the kind that is because you have all the money in the world or all the things that you need. It's the kind of peace. He says, not the one that the world gives. It's a special peace that we find in spite of our problems. So Paul concludes his writing in Romans chapter 12. We're looking at 20 now. We're going back to chapter 12 of Romans. We read 19, we're looking at verse 20 now. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. 21, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Because someone has done you hurt, bad, you want to give him evil in return. Christians don't do that. You think this is very hard to do? It can be, or if we fail to follow the standard that Jesus, our Master, has set. It is only after setting that standard that we can strive to go the extra mile to better our spiritual and physical well-being. You run in a race, you fall down, you pick yourself, you dust yourself up, you continue. You must set the standard of finishing and finishing strong. There is a special reason why we must do this. It is explained in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5 verse 45. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. God is fair to all, even in judgment. After condemning Adam and Eve, his thoughts towards them remain good. Genesis chapter 3 verse 19. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. 21. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothes. Even in judgment, he was sending them out of the beauty of Eden. He had put a curse upon them. Out of the sweat of thy brow shalt thou eat bread. Cursed is the land for your sake. And yet, he didn't want them to go naked. He made clothes for them. So what are we learning about God and ourselves? We must understand that there is no room for hatred or bitterness or unforgiveness. It will rob us of a lot of other blessings that we would have had. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 and 27, God said, let us make man in our own image after our likeness. So we are in the image and likeness of God. The image, the form, head, hand, like, and the likeness, the spirit that is in us. And if that is the case, we must deliberately be like him. We must progressively be like him. So it is easy to appreciate then how Jesus forgave those people who crucified him as a standard of love. And Stephen, to the standard that he chose, was able to develop himself to that capacity. Because if there is no standard set, anything goes. Now, can you forgive this? I want to share a story. Because many of us, you want money for school fees, someone didn't give you, I will never forgive my mother for not giving me that money. You want 10 naira, you can't have it, I will never forgive. We don't know what we are talking. Because the spirit that is in us is not the spirit of God. A female student at Kabarak University in Nakuru, Kenya, has confessed that she deliberately infected 324 men with HIV, according to the Kenyan Daily Post. The girl, 19, whose name is unknown, says she has set her target for at least 2,000 men, acting in revenge after she was infected by a man at a party. The girl allegedly contacted Kenyan scandals. After she was assured her identity was going to be protected, the Kenyan Daily Post, however, published a picture from her Facebook profile along with the article. She wrote, quote, September 22nd, 2013 is a day I will never forget. We went clubbing in town and got drunk with some senior students. Then we went back hostels for party round two. She then explained that when she woke up the morning after, she realized a boy called Javan had had sex with her while she was drunk. I only asked if he used a condom and he said yes. However, when taking my bath, I noticed sperm down there. I wanted to commit suicide. I feared getting pregnant and HIV. When she discovered she was HIV positive, the girl confronted Javan, who insisted he was clean. I was so depressed and took alcohol to die. I even bought poison. The pain was just unbearable. How was I going to face the world? I let my parents down. I gave up the world and just wanted to end my life. My future had been ruined. Somehow, somebody has got to pay. I accepted my fate and promised to make all men I come across suffer. I know I'm attractive, so men chase after me left, right, and center. I buried the good girl in me and became a bad girl. My goal was to infect as many as possible, she explained. She then confessed she had already infected 324 men. 156 of them were students in her university. The rest, politicians, lawyers, lecturers. Not a day passes without me having sex, mostly four people per day. Nothing will stop me from accomplishing my mission by continuing to sleep around. You never know, but maybe you have slept with me or your husband, boyfriend, brother, father, or anyone has slept with me. You never know. Your day is coming. You men destroyed my life, and I will make you and your people pay for it. One man destroyed his life. He says, all men. Everything you do starts from the inside. How you respond is a function of the kind of spirit that you carry. After the Kenyan Daily Post reported the news, someone made an anonymous comment claiming he knows the girl and that he has already had intercourse with her. This girl is adamant, nonchalant. If you were so infested, will you forgive her? Can you forgive her? Should you forgive her? Even if she comes to you and says, oh, I'm sorry, I was wrong, I did this, but I don't want to anymore, I'm sorry. Can you forgive her? I want us to treat this very specially and realistically too, because it is inside of this that our change will come. I want a sincere, interactive class right now. Don't say what people want you to say. Don't say what you want people to hear. I want somebody, if you were one of these men, and we are learning about forgiveness, can you forgive?
Sir, the truth is that I will forgive her.
Thank you.
I will not. Should I shoot her down?
All right. Praise the Lord. But I just spoke honestly. He will not forgive her. He will blow a hole in her head instead. Okay?
Praise Master Jesus. The word forgiveness, sometimes there's one word that I'm trying to understand. Because several times I've made up my mind never to forgive some persons. But the moment I see them again, I don't know. I'm always the first to want to like restart doing things with them again. Even my former boss told me some time back that stop using that language, I will never forgive because I've never seen you hurting anybody. So each time I come in contact with people talking about the forgiveness thing, as a Christian, I always see it like, is it really a matter of our choice or sometimes our body just pushing us to do it? So I fail to always answer some certain question of whether I will forgive or not. That I will tell you, let me just experience it first, because I've never seen anybody I've not forgiven.
You got to have HIV first before you have HIV. It did not be your portion in Jesus. Now you see, forgiveness, yes sir, just a moment. You should never ever say again, I will never forgive that person. Instead, you may say, God give me grace to forgive that person. Unless you've never been hurt in life, if you've been hurt by the people that you love, that the people you have done everything for, you naturally will feel pain. to ask for the extra grace. Remember, I saw Romans chapter 5, verse 5. It is the Holy Spirit that gives us grace to love abroad. By ourselves, it will not be possible. Never say again, I will never forgive. We must forgive. That's what we are learning in the class today. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Pastor, personally, I don't know this girl, but inside of me, I can feel myself boiling already with anger. But the truth is this. The girl in question, she's out for a target. She didn't come into my living room to force me to sleep with her. So I have to be rational about the whole thing. Who am I to blame in the first instance? Myself. So with this understanding, I should know therefore that whether or not I forgive her, the fault comes from me. So definitely I should be able to let go of the whole thing and try to find a way to move on with my life.
Thank you. That is Thomas' contribution. Whose fault is it? You went there. Even if you didn't go to her, if she came to you, whatever it was, you have a commandment to forgive. Because the journey that you are on is long, is tortuous. You don't need to carry extra burden on yourself. Let go so that you can focus. All you need to do is to reconnect with God. All your prayer, your desire is to reconnect with God. And God is watching you to see whether your reconnection is sincere or whether you are going to prove a point to anyone. It doesn't matter to those people. It doesn't matter to them. If you become successful in your life, it is your business. You might have $10 million and not give me 1 cent because it's your money. So why should I waste my energy on your race when I have mine to run? It is easy if we can set the standard and say, I must forgive. I want to attain that place that no matter what anyone does to me, I forgive them. The moment I got there after this last crisis, once I got to that place, I had peace of mind. I had peace no matter what I heard, no matter what someone did, all of a sudden it didn't matter. Therefore, I learned something. Your attitude will determine your altitude. Whether it is in business or in spiritual race or your relationship with one another, your attitude will determine whether you are a success material or a failure material. If I were a managing director and I was going to appoint someone, I'm not going to appoint somebody who is always, if it's I'm not going to do this, if it's I'm going to back off. You don't want somebody who will desert you. You want someone who will understand what you're doing, who will stand by you, somebody who is rugged. You are looking for the strong. And remember, only the strong survive. So you must decide right now what you want to do. Every one of us has a weakness. Unless we take those weaknesses one by one and deal with them, almost all of us have the tendency not to forgive. Husbands and wives have had problems, and the wife says, I will never forgive you. The man says, I will never forgive. How can you never forgive someone when you are not perfect yourself? If you are not perfect, you have no right to demand perfection from somebody else. So you need to know that how I relate with others, how I forgive the people around me, that is how God will forgive me. If I don't forgive, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. If I do not forgive, then don't forgive me too. But that is not to say that as humans, we don't have that first reaction. You see your wife, you're getting angry. You see your husband, you are angry. You see your children, you are so frustrated because they have done something to you. But God will open the eyes of our understanding and transform us collectively as a people in the mighty name of Jesus. Yes.
Okay. Praise the Lord. Truth is that the thing is painful, but we forgive her sincerely. The plan is that I don't have the cure, neither she have the cure. If I have the cure, I will send for her. But well, if I did not forgive her, the reason why we forgive her is that if I did not forgive her, whatever it will cost me, he has cost me. So because he has cost me, whatever it will cost me, I have to forgive because it will cost me. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Pastor, like what you rightly said, I want to believe that to forgive somebody who has wronged you, sometimes it took the grace of God to forgive. I never knew you. This topic was preached last week. Something happened yesterday, the issue of my own mother-in-law. This is something of 2008. It was yesterday afternoon. I carried my family. We went straight to my mother-in-law. People came from Isoko for the settlement. We all gathered. It's just like a dream. It was just like a dream. I never knew you preached this message last week. So in above all, the grace and the specific time in which God has prepared for that settlement to be abolished. If not, you might settle today. Tomorrow, the small grudge will still be there. But like what happened yesterday now, before God and man, it was very open and a sincere forgiveness. Thank you, sir.
I remember one of us here had an issue with that person, and I, we are related, so we have a common home. And one day I said to him, go and tell that man you are sorry. Go and apologize to that man. Because many times you think you are winning. I'm going to show this person. But spiritually, that person is dealing with you because you are making yourself. And he went and said to the man, I am sorry, forgive me. You know what the guy said? He said, go and thank that man who told you to come and forgive me. Which means this man had planned something major to destabilize me. So when you understand that this battle is not the physical one that you see, when you forgive, you remove the burden from yourself and the Lord takes it. When you hold on to unforgiveness, you're making it easy for the devil to relate with you and frustrate you. So when it says forgive, it is because you want to move forward. That is why you have to forgive. There was a lady who had so much bitterness in her heart, hatred. But one day, she was just rolling on the floor. I forgive this person. She was dying, just rolling in pain. I forgive this person. I said this thing against you. I'm sorry, I did this one. I forgive you. Immediately, she was healed. Immediately, she got up from the floor, a healed woman. So when Jesus said forgive, do good to the ones, and that is the worst part. If we're having trouble forgiving one another, how about doing good to the people that you cannot even say, I forgive you to? So somebody comes and says, I think I said this not long ago, I had a problem in Belgium. I had to fly down from England to go and help a family just so that they can be all right. And I had challenges. I didn't want that to happen. Nobody wants that to happen. Pride will come in. You were dying here. I came and I gave you money to do this, and now you are doing so and so. So I ran into trouble. I was, because of them, repatriated from England. When I went back, because I went by sea, a town they call Dover. The border in Belgium is called Ostend. So you take a ferry from Ostend to Dover, the border of England, the entry point. And because I had given them all the money that I had to stay with in England, when I was going back into England, they said, where is my statement of account? They looked at it, I had no money. I'd taken all the money and given to somebody who was in trouble in Belgium. You can't enter England again. You have to go back to Belgium. I was repatriated to Belgium. So I went to the house of this fellow. I didn't have any money, so I had to go to his house to stay. And he said to me, everybody has his own problem. Now I brought my problem to him now to add to his problem. What would you do? My money is still with you. But you see, the selfishness of man brings pride out of you, and you say the things that you shouldn't say, and you wish people the things you shouldn't wish them. So I came home from there. I came back to Nigeria, and a few weeks later I was back. Not long after that, I was in Belgium again, and I saw this lady in a tube underground station, and she was very happy. She was a good person. The man is the nasty one. The wife is a good person. And she said to me, look, she was sorry all those things that happened. Do I know things are very hard for them, her fees and all that? And I said, fees? How can I pay fees for somebody that put me in trouble? My flesh took control, and I said, well, to hell with them. If they send them home, that would be their business. But when she left, I couldn't sleep. I knew that I had to forgive them. And I called her and gave her money for her fees. It is not a natural thing to do, but I think every one of us has the way God made them. I find peace when I give, but I have my struggles in other areas. So if you have struggled giving, if you don't know how to give, you are likely to make trouble where you shouldn't. So you see, these are things that we must meet with and things that we must deal with. Because until the point where you know that you are nobody, until the point where you will die to self, you will always be bitter. And the worst person to be bitter with is your spouse or with your children. If you have bitterness or with anyone in the church, you must remove bitterness because you are destroying your own happiness. There are many reasons why we find it difficult to forgive. And the primary reason is because we elevate the pain above its normal degree. Okay, so I lose $1 million. So what? It's a lot of money to lose, but it's not enough to buy human life. If you raise that loss to a higher degree, it is the reason why people kill other people. Why people can say, I will never forgive this person. Why people can say all the things that they do. Say. When I was overseas, my dad sent money. I had suffered. In those days, remittance was very difficult to do. To pay fees and all that, you had to go through your branch, go to head office, you go to central bank, before they would remit your school fees to you, wherever you were. And the process was so terrible, it took forever. And you were dying overseas. So when the money came, my dad inflated it so I should pay some money into his account and pay my fees and take this and take that. The mistake was that the whole money hit my account. Yes, truly, I skanked. I went into space. Because I remembered how I suffered. In the morning at 4 a.m., I woke up and I would wait outside for the bus to come. In the winter, your ears were like you didn't have ears anymore because of cold. And you catch a bus to go work. I was working at the independent television. When I say I was working at the independent television, don't think I was a broadcaster. I was a cleaner. But it's better to say I was working at the independent television. So you had to go there, you cleaned, you did everything that you had to do before they resumed work. And then you had to go to school. From school, we went for another one at Shell Mex in the Strand. Say working in Shell. Well, you know what work I was doing in Shell. Clean the offices after they had left there. Life was not funny. It was difficult. So I had ideas before the money came. And once it came, took the money and I was gone. And that's how I started business, by the way, with that money, and we began. So my dad naturally was angry. He couldn't understand. And he was, so one day when they came visiting and he came to my house, my mom said to him, bless the child. I didn't know what struggles they have had. I was living my life. And my mom said, bless the child. And I said, no, I've forgiven him. Mommy said, no, bless the child. So my mom made me kneel down before my father and he blessed me. It was at that point that I even knew that, well, I knew I wronged him, but I didn't know how bitter he was towards me. Once he blessed me and forgave me, there was peace in his life and there was peace in mine. There is no need to carry unnecessary burden. There is no need. Because you are the one on the journey. You are the one that is going someplace. You don't need to carry all those excesses. You don't need those. You have to make the journey as light as you possibly can. So forgiveness is not because of the other person. It is because of you. Everyone that you are angry with, when you see the person, if you can look in the mirror, you will understand what I'm saying. Your face will change to a monster's. But you think you are okay in your heart. So the reason why we fail to forgive, the reason why we choose bitterness over forgiveness, is because we over-elevate the pain. Someone might get hurt the same way and he just says, okay, that's all right, and he moves on. You know, but somebody else might say, no, this one I must, and that is why we have problems. There is nothing that a Christian cannot forgive. There is another short story. I'll just quickly take this and then we will take questions. If this one happened to you or your sibling or your sister, what would you do? A man said to his wife, after 2 days of marriage, according to Gulf News, the man reportedly said that he thought something was wrong with his bride after witnessing a series of incidents. He claims that on their first day together, the curtains of the flat where they went to spend their honeymoon came down on the floor. He also noted that the waiter who was serving them when they went out for their first dinner slipped and fell. The man added that when they returned to the flat, the bottle of perfume he was holding also fell to the floor when he told his bride that, oh, this perfume has a very great smell, and it fell. The Saudi news site Al Masrad reported. Following these incidents, the man thought that all the falls that occurred after the marriage were a negative sign and that his wife was going to bring bad luck to his life. Therefore, he decided to divorce her. The next day, he took her to her family's home and told her parents that, man, I'm not going to marry this lady anymore. Well, as usual, social media users are taking issue up, criticizing the man for his attitude. Now, someone wrote, does he think that marriage is such a trivial matter, a blogger asked? Does he think that you can marry a woman and divorce her so easily over such trivial matters? He obviously needs help. He should not be allowed to play with people's emotions as he wishes. Well, everyone has their own reaction. But he who wears the shoes knows where it pinches. If you're a superstitious person, you will end up. There are many lessons that we can learn from this. But I guess that we can take that till our next class. Praise the Lord. Any questions so far? Brother Emeka?
You forgive and you forget. Is it possible?
I don't believe that you can forgive and forget. It is not possible.
It's not possible.
But when they say forgive and forget,
yes,
it means don't use the memory of this to relate.
If you don't forget, there is no way you can forgive, because that thing still keep on haunting you. And more so, I don't think forgiveness should be absolute, because the scripture says that God Almighty can forgive all sins, but the sin against the Holy Spirit cannot be forgiven. So you can see that there is limit to forgiveness if God cannot forgive. Obviously. Thank you, sir.
Praise the Lord. You know, you made a very good point. The sin against the Holy Ghost will not be forgiven in this world nor in the world to come. But that is God's prerogative. That is God's judgment. He knows who he is. We are not God. We are going to be judged. So because we want to enjoy the benefit of his forgiveness, the same way that we ask for forgiveness for ourselves, God will look at that and know whether I should forgive this person. Because if you hold something against somebody else, then God has the right not to forgive you what you're asking him for. So the reason why we forgive is not because of the other person, it is because of you. Because I know that Jesus taught us to pray, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Indicating that even though I am begging you to forgive me, if I have bitterness in my heart for my brother or my sister, I am not going to be forgiven. So the reason why we forgive, it's not because of the other person. The reason why, even though we remember, the reason why we may remember, because you can't forget, let's not kid ourselves, only time can make us forget. But to the extent that we allow time to help us forget, we'll forget it sooner. And there might be something that works against you now, something that you are so angry with. And over time, you look back and you wonder, well, what was I killing myself over that for? You know, so it's a degree of your perception. And maturity brings it to that point. Every one of us has done something and you look back and I say, but how could I have been so stupid? Because you have done it and it has passed. But while you were doing it, it didn't look so stupid. But to God, because he's all-knowing, it was stupid from the one. So for you to catch his attention, forgive. So that when you ask God to forgive you, he too will forgive you. Praise the Lord. Does it make sense, sir, to you?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Pastor, in addition to what you just said, from my own personal experience, I have discovered that grudges, secrets, these two things, they take a whole lot of energy to keep inside. Like for myself, for the past 8 months to a year now, I've been holding something inside of me from my parents. Just a while ago, my dad called me and he was like, what did they do you? You did lose weight too. That was during the fasting period. I couldn't help it. I broke down in tears. I told him everything that has been happening. He was mad. But later on that day, he called me. He said, okay, this is where you went wrong. I hope you learned something from it. So the point is this. For every particular important incident in our life, there's a lesson to be learned.
Yes.
If you forget, then that means you've not learned anything from that incident. So definitely, you can forgive, but you will not be able to forget unless with enough time.
Yes.
So there's no way you'll forgive and forget just immediately. That's what I have to point out.
Very well put. God bless you. Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Pastor, I want to ask, does it really mean that our enemies have to be in persons? I see that most of us, our enemies are our witnesses. What we call enemies are our own making. We just call people enemies because of our own weaknesses. So I would like you to separate our weaknesses from our enemies. Somebody woke up very late. He's supposed to resume at work 7 o'clock. Woke up very late. While on his way, somebody looked him somehow. When he got to his office, was being scolded, he said, ah, now that man will look me anyhow for road. Now that man, I need that they call me for office. So he could not see that it was because he was late.
Yeah.
That's why he was being scolded. So I want you to tell us our weaknesses and our enemies. We should be able to know. Because the Bible says that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers. So we should be able to separate our weaknesses from our own enemies or our foundation. Covenants that are fighting our destiny, we should be able to separate them from the me and you that we see every day. So don't just call everybody enemy, enemy, enemy. There are some things from our foundation that are fighting us. There are some things that our own weaknesses are causing us. We just call people enemy and enemy, enemy everywhere. So I want you to kind of separate it for us so we don't just go home with that mentality that this man is my enemy, this one is my enemy. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Yeah, you all heard this point, yes? Where the question? Your enemy is anything that works against you. That is the simple definition of an enemy. I had a distant uncle, my cousin. I had distant cousins, or rather, I had a distant uncle on my paternal mother's side. My father's mother is from Ekigbo, Inu Valley. And there was a cousin of ours. There were strong armed robbers in that family. Every time they settled cases, took them to police station, two boys, they were killed for armed robbery in Ekigbo. Not long after that, their father confessed that he was the one that was pushing them to steal. So, I gave that example to show that the enemy can really be somebody else. But what does the enemy use? They use your weakness. If you want to go fishing, you don't put a cow in a hook to go and catch a fish. You will get something that you know fish would like. So they connect with your weakness. I recall again another brother of ours he had the anger problem. And they will set a trap for that. And when God showed it, he was able to overcome that. It's your weakness that they will use. It is not right to always blame other people. If you are blaming people, you will never address your inadequacies. But the moment you look at it and say, I have erred. King David, when he made what mistake he made, he didn't quarrel, even they wanted to make trouble at first. But when they told him he was the one, he said, I have sinned. And he began to beg, don't take the Holy Spirit from me. I've sinned. Only against you have I sinned. In sin did my mother conceive me. All of you have to admit that, well, I have made a mistake because of my own inadequacies. So your enemy can be that inadequacy. Because that is what the enemy will connect with. If you like drink, that is where they're going to set the trap for you. If you want drugs, that's where they're going to set it. If you like women, that's where they're going to set the trap. So your weakness is what they will use against you. So everything that works against you, whether it is in you or from outside, is your enemy. But my prayer is that whether it's from inside or from outside, that God will give us grace to overcome, pick ourselves up and go and accomplish our mission by the power that is in the mighty name of Jesus. You made a very good point. Everything that happens to you is so that you can learn a lesson. May God help us to learn blessings that we ought in the name of Jesus. And because of all those troubled times, we left so many things undone. So from this Saturday, we're going to start baptism. Everyone who would like to get baptized this Saturday, please write your name with Brother Cyril. Remember that baptism must be in the name of Jesus Christ only. It is not in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. It has to be a baptism in the name of Jesus. So if you haven't had that baptism, Saturday, by the grace of God, at 10 o'clock, we shall meet here, study the Bible, and then go and get baptized. And as we do so, may the power of God come upon those who will baptize and transform us as a church in the mighty name of Jesus. God bless you all.